Many people have questions about Lazarus kits on GEDmatch. What do you use them for? Why would you want to do that? How do you make them? So today I'm going to go over how we can make a Lazarus kit. Now, the really easy question to answer is, what is a Lazarus kit? And in this essence, a Lazarus kit is a kit that is creating the DNA of a deceased person. In other words, we don't actually have their DNA, but we're going to use their relatives to recreate their DNA. Now, knowing that that is what a Lazarus kit is, it really helps answer one of the other questions. Why would you want to use a Lazarus kit? Pretty easy, because we want to find relatives of our ancestors. And if we can actually recreate a DNA kit that somewhat resembles one of our ancestors, then hopefully we can find other relatives of that ancestor. So it is a nice way of being able to combine a bunch of DNA kits to hopefully have another kit that is useful somewhat. So let's go over the process of creating a Lazarus kit. Now on GEDmatch, under the Lazarus tool, it has a lot of information about how to create a kit. There's an upload button, there is information about who this is for, what the sex of the new kit is, this thresholds, how processing, and then we get into these groups, group 0, group 1, group 2, group 3. And this can be really daunting because it looks like there's a lot of information to fill out. But there isn't. There can be if you happen to have a lot of information. But not every kit is going to have all that information. So let's go over the basic groups of what is in a Lazarus kit. First off is group 0. Now in group 0, you are going to want to have the spouse or the relatives of the spouse. And in particular, they are not related to the target person. So you wouldn't have the children of that spouse, but you would have their brothers and sisters, their aunts and uncles, their parents, or any other relative that is related to the spouse, but not related to the target person. Group 1, then, is we want to have the descendants of the target person. This is usually going to be children, but if you don't have children, you can also use grandchildren or great-grandchildren. The key here is we're talking about descendants. We're not just talking about relatives, but we're talking about descendants of that target person. Now, with this, there's a principle to understand. The more that we have, and the closer related that they have, the better our results are going to be. And that's just because we're going to have more DNA to be able to pull from to create our Lazarus kit. In essence, if you just have one child, you have 50% of that target person's DNA represented in that one child. If you have two of their children, you actually have 75% of that DNA. With three children, you have 88%, four children, 94%, and five children, you have 97% of that DNA represented within those children. You want to pull together as many descendants as possible, recognizing that if you have a child's DNA, you don't need that child's children. In other words, those grandchildren from that line's DNA, because you have all the DNA represented with that child. But if somebody had multiple children, you want to get as many of those children's DNA as possible. And then we come to group 2. And group 2 is the important one. We want to ask ourselves a question, well, what does GEDmatch do with these? Let's go through a little graphic example to see what is happening with this DNA. So this big circle here represents group 1, represents the DNA, all of the DNA that group 1 has. Now group 2 is the other relatives of our target person, and so they have some DNA that is shared with group 1. In other words, this is the DNA that is potentially going to go into the Lazarus kit. So if we overlap these two groups, we can then draw a little outline of what that DNA is that we are hoping to get. Now, you might have noticed we haven't talked about group 0 yet, because what we need to do next is we actually need to subtract out group 0, because group 0 is the spouse or the spouse's relatives. They're going to share a lot of DNA with group 1, because they are also one of the parents of group 1. And they might share some DNA with group two as well, depending on what the relationship is. So we want to subtract out that DNA, and then what we are left with is we are left with this little representation of what that Lazarus DNA is going to be made up of. Let's go over what you need to fill in on the form now. We can skip this first part about uploading a file. We need to put in the name of the deceased person. If we want to put some comments as far as how we're building this kit, we can put some comments in there. And then we want to list the sex of the new person. For the threshold, I leave that where it is at. You can always play around with the threshold with some different kits. But to begin with, we're just going to leave that threshold at that 6 centimorgans. Next is the processing, whether we want to just do a trial run. And I recommend that you do a trial run of any kit before you actually do the full processing of it. So I'm going to click on the trial run. And what that means is it's not actually going to create a kit. It's going to go through the analysis of what that kit would potentially look like as far as total centimorgans and what the segments are. Next on this list is this generate button. And we don't actually want to press that button yet. We want to fill in our groups first. Group zero, remember, is the spouse. Now, if we don't have the spouse's kit, then we can put in some spouse's relatives, as many as we can. Next is going to be group number one. Now, group number one are the descendants of our target person. So we have a child, we maybe have another child, we might have a grandchild and another grandchild, and any other direct descendants of that person that we can have. Now, GEDmatch allows us to put up to 10 people in groups one and group two. So with group two, these are going to be other relatives of the target that are not necessarily their descendants. A brother, a sister, an uncle, maybe a cousin, maybe even a distant cousin that you've actually just found as far as a match on GEDmatch. This DNA from all of these people here is going to be compared to group one to figure out what DNA we can put into a Lazarus kit. Now in group two, we can actually add up to 100 people in this group. And then of course there is another generate button at the bottom. Now we can actually generate our Lazarus kit. So if you have multiple children of this target person, then I would recommend an actually a little hack that somebody taught me on how to make a really good Lazarus kit. We're gonna start again with the name of the person. So this will be my grandfather, and this will be a good kit. The sex of that person, I'm gonna leave that threshold the same. I'm just gonna make a trial run of this one. Now for group zero, I happen to have my grandmother's DNA, so I'm going to put that in. And for group one, I have a daughter, his second child. I have a son, his third child. I have a grandson through his fourth child. So I don't actually have her DNA, but I have her son's DNA. I have a son, which was his sixth child. And I have a daughter, his seventh child. And I have a daughter, his eighth child. He had eight children. That's 10. Eight children. And I have five of those children's DNA plus another grandson of his through one of the other kids. So I actually have six lines of his descent. So there should be a lot of DNA available for this. Now, remember I said in group two, we're going to put the other relatives of the target person. In this case, I'm actually going to repeat all of the people that I had above. And that's because I have multiple people. So the comparisons are going to be between each of those people. So I just list the daughter, the son, the grandson, the son, the daughter, and the daughter, and the son again. So I'm listing the same people in group one and group two because I have several children of this target person. Now, if you only have one child of this target person, this isn't going to necessarily work very well. If you just have grandchildren of the target person, this also won't necessarily work as well. You might want to use other relatives for this. But the nice thing is, you can create as many Lazarus kits as you want, so feel free to play around with them. So let's see the results of this Lazarus kit. Now this, like I said, is actually a pretty good Lazarus kit by doing this technique. We can scroll down here and we can see, hey, actually, it honestly doesn't look that good. There's not that many matches. There's a little segment there. There's some other bits here and there. But it doesn't necessarily look like this is that good of a Lazarus kit. But in all honesty, this is a pretty good Lazarus kit. You may be wondering, well, why or how is this a good Lazarus kit? Remember, we are only putting in here what we definitely know from the group one and group two comparisons, subtracting out the group zero. Let me go and let me look at this at full resolution so we can actually see how much of this is actual matches. Okay, so this looks a little better. As we're looking at this now, we can see that there's actually quite a bit of yellow or green even in many places. And here's, you know, it's not calling it a segment because there's no blue there, but there actually is a sizable part that is a match that's being created from this. Here is that segment that it was showing before. And we can see this throughout all of these chromosomes. So this is what a good Lazarus kit actually is going to look like compared to the real person. So this is a Lazarus of my grandfather compared to my grandfather's DNA. So next, what I want to do is I want to tell you how to get the best Lazarus kits. Not everybody is going to be able to get the best Lazarus kits simply because you have to have some specific information. And in that case, let's go through a graphic of what we want to do. First off, with group one, we are going to actually not just use his children, but we're going to use the phased kits of his children. Because remember, I have my grandmother's DNA. So because I have the children, plus I have one of their parents, I can use the phasing tool on GEDmatch in order to create phased kits. So now I'm going to use the phased group one, and I'm going to use the phased group two, which is going to overlap it. And you'll notice I have group zero outside of here because I'm using the paternal kits for these children. Now there's going to be some DNA that just one child has, which is why you don't see complete overlap between these two groups. And so that DNA can't be added into the Lazarus kit because we need to actually compare it to something else. But what we are able to get from this is we are able to get a really large amount of DNA between these two groups because we've really taken out all the noise by phasing these two kits. So let me show you what this is going to look like in GEDmatch. Here we have my grandfather, the best kit. Now this is the best possible kit that could be made for my grandfather based on the DNA that we have. He's male, we're gonna leave it at that 6 centimorgans. I'm gonna start with trial runs, but again, after I've done a trial run and I'm happy with what the results are, which I'll show you here in a second, then we can go to the full processing. In group zero, I'm still gonna put my grandmother. Even though I'm using these phased paternal kits, I wanna make sure that I have any segments that belong to my grandmother taken out of that group. Then I have the phased daughter, the phased son. I just still have the grandson because I don't have his phase data. Because if I did have his phase data, I'd actually be using his mom for this rather than him. I have the phased son and then the other two phased daughters. So I have 5 phased kits plus 1 unphased kit. And I'm doing that for group 1 and group 2. So it's basically going to cross compare all the DNA between these 6 people in order to come up with this Lazarus kit. So I can go down all the way to the bottom because I don't need all 100 of these kits, just the 6. I can click on the generate button. So when I put the actual kit numbers in, here is what it is going to be looking like. One thing to remember, and this is why you do the trial runs here, is the Lazarus kits are not going to be useful unless you can get at least 1500 centimorgans. Now, if you only have one child and a couple of relatives, you're probably not going to get to 1500 centimorgans. But if you have 2 or 3 children or you have a lot of relatives that you can add in, then you might be able to get not only to that 1,500 Center Morgans, but even more, as you will see. Next on the results here is the list of contributions. And this is just comparing the people to the other people. And you can see that there are a lot of these because there's a lot of comparisons because these are all children or the one grandchild. Now from this, it is going to actually go and pull out the Lazarus segments. In other words, the bits of DNA that match enough that we can call it a Lazarus segment. At the bottom of that, you can see, hey, there's 3,560 centimorgans represented by this kit. And then here are the different contributing ones to it. Now at the bottom, there's some information that may be informational for you. It tells you how many single allele SNPs there are, and that means that there's just one letter on them instead of the two letters like you would expect. How many biallelic, and this is really what we want, is we want to maximize the number of biallelic SNPs because that is going to be a real true comparison with other people. So I got 404,000 biallelic SNPs and 111,000 single allelic SNPs. So this is actually a really good kit in the number of SNPs that it has, as well as the total centimorgans. Now, depending on what kits are being used, this was all made with 23andMe and Ancestry kits. If you are using some of the newer 23andMe kits or the newer, MyHeritage and FamilyTree DNA that use a new chipset, you're not going to see as high of SNP counts as you see here, just because there's not as much that is already used for the database that GEDmatch uses. It's going to give you a kit number, which is going to show up on your front page and tell you that, hey, you're going to have to wait 24 to 48 hours before you can actually do the one-to-many comparisons, but there's some utilities you can use right of way. Let me show you on the homepage where all these are popping up. So here you can see I have several Lazarus kits that I've created for different reasons. And I know that because they have this L1 at the end of them. So they get a new kit number. You can see each one of these kit numbers is different, but then they have an L1 put on it. And so that means that this L1 is a Lazarus kit. Now you can use these kits with any of the other tools in GEDmatch. So if you want to do one-to-one comparisons, if you want to do a one-to-many, if you want to use them in the multiple kit analysis or other things like that, you can use these kits just like you can use any other kit. So let's take a look at how different the phased kit that I used was compared to the other kits. So here are the results of this phased kit. That's a big difference. By using the phased kit, I've already separated out what I know is just the paternal information. And so it is able to actually put together a lot more of the SNPs in line than it was before. And what that ends up doing is it ends up making most everything a half match at least. And there might be a few places where there is a full match. Let's just scroll down and see. I think most of this is just going to be half all the way through, which is okay because before I had nothing. Yeah, there's a few little spots where I'm getting a little bit, but not enough to actually have a full match segment by the definitions that they use. But the other thing you can see is all of these chromosomes, we are matching all the way across. So this is the difference of using phased data as opposed to unphased data when you're creating your Lazarus kit. Now, like I said, to make that best Lazarus kit, you have to be able to have one parent in order to create that phased data. But if you don't have that, you can still create Lazarus kits. Yes, they're not going to be as good as the best, but they're better than nothing because before you had no DNA for this person as far as in one kit to be able to look at. Be sure to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. But if you'd like to learn something else about DNA, then check out this video up above.